slight chance of making the all-important top eight. Western Bulldogs are the new leaders.
The Baseball Hall of Fame is the main attraction of Cooperstown in upstate New York. The world-famous Yankees and Babe Ruth take pride of place in the museum, and it seems throughout this tiny burg. Everywhere you go, baseball memorabilia shops cater to the needs of an estimated annual 400,000 visitors. But if you look hard enough behind this idyllic facade, you'll find the bloody origins of the modern United States. Built on the edge of the mighty Susquehanna River, Cooperstown holds a significant position in Native American history. For one thing, Cooperstown is named after James Fenimore Cooper, author of that literary classic, The Last of the Mohicans. And more tragically, it was down this stretch of river that the subjugation of the Iroquois nation began when General George Clinton launched his famous attack.
He brought in 200 pre-built bateaux and over 1,800 troops, and he secretly put a dam at Otsego Lake in Cooperstown and then broke the dam, flooding the river valley and also allowing his troops to march and bring their boats down the Susquehanna River.
That devious military maneuver is the inspiration behind the General Clinton Canoe Marathon, of which Tad Palmer is a co-organizer. This race attracts the world's top paddlers, including one familiar to regular viewers of Transworld Sport.
I feel great. I'm 40 now and I should be too old, but it keeps me fit. The portages might be a problem, but I think we'll do quite well.
Corbin is as confident as ever. Others fear the unique demands of the General Clinton.
I think the first hour of the race is definitely the most important because there are lots of obstacles in the water to overcome and the course is very technical.
Even so, Lynch starts as one of the favorites to win this grueling 70-mile race from Otsego Lake in Cooperstown to General Clinton Park just outside Bainbridge. There are three vital obstacles to overcome, with dams in Cooperstown, Goodyear Lake, and Oneonta. The competitors must carry their craft, sometimes for several hundred meters, before resuming their paddling. The 61 two-man pro teams get underway at 8 a.m. and will be joined by nearly 3,000 amateurs along the route. There's no surprise when reigning champion Corbin and teammate Greg Barton lead the way, closely followed by Michigan men Bruce Barton and Jeff Colker. This narrow stretch gives the paddlers ample opportunity to take on extra food and drink. After all, they'll be on the river for 7 or more hours. From 10th place, the Quebecois team of Lynch and Normand Mangui in P39 start to edge their way up the field. Corbin and Barton build up a 2-minute lead as the racing heads out onto the flatter waters that lead up to Goodyear Lake. Those trailing in their wake have to contend with all manner of dangers, some of them self-inflicted. Despite his age, Corbin, never a loser here in 19 previous races, shows little signs of fatigue as he demonstrates to an amateur field, aged from a worldly wise 4 to a sprightly 75, what it's all about. Corbin and Barton maintain their lead over Oneonta Dam. These portages are now proving crucial for Lynch and Mangi's strategy as their greater fitness on terra firma sees them move up to third. Others seem to be carrying excess ballast or are just lacking in basic coordination. By the Otsego stretch of the Susquehanna, Corbin and Barton have been reined in. The Quebecois team in P39 and Strieve and Rankinen in P12 are vying for the lead. But by Wells Bridge, the legendary canoe marathoners have pulled clear once more, Barton and Corbin leaving the rest in their wake. It's a repeat victory for the champions as they finish 95 seconds ahead of second place Lynch and Mauricie. Barton and Corbin claim the General Clinton, the first leg in their defense of North America's other prestigious Triple Crown. The boundaries of two great lakes enclose the peninsula of Michigan. At its heart, in the depths of the 400,000-acre Huron National Forest, is the town of Grayling. The town's transport and communication needs are now handled by modern highways and automobiles. It wasn't always so. Before the railroad appeared to carry this logging area's precious wooden cargo, the AuSable River was its main artery. It was in the spirit of early logging pioneers that the AuSable River Canoe Marathon was started.
Well, it came about basically just two fellas trying to figure out whether you could go from here to Oscoda nonstop. And from that, it grew into a race, a gentlemanly race at first, and now a very serious one.
The 47th edition of North America's toughest canoe race is a 14-hour nonstop 120-mile marathon from Grayling to Oscoda. It's run overnight to counteract the debilitating effect of high midsummer temperatures, and it includes six dams or portages over which the competitors have to carry their canoes.
Three, two, one, go!
Pre-race sprints determine which of the 36 teams of two will take pole position for the main event. The Canadian pairing of Serge Corbin and Solomon Carrière are attempting to add a second successive title to their considerable collection. They took a clean sweep of North America's three premier canoe marathon races last year, the so-called Triple Crown of AuSable, La Classique in Canada, and the General Clinton Regatta in New York State. Again, they faced tough competition from Michigan's own pairing of Jeff Calker and Bill Taranjo, who last year finished just 1 minute behind the Canadians. At 9 o'clock on Saturday evening, Corbin and Carrière take pole on the brow of Grayling's main street, with a 6 mile run separating them from the expectant 15,000 crowd who've gathered below. Bang. Patrick Lynch and Jim Harwood take the lead as the epic journey into night begins.
Go, Jimmy!
With 50,000 fans following events along the course, the paddlers take on supplies from feeders placed at strategic points. The marathon is literally non-stop, and the paddlers have to do everything on the move. Hours into the race, Corbin and Carrière hold the lead as they traverse the first of the major dams, the Mio Dam. Taranjo and Kolka follow them, with two more teams less than 2 minutes behind.
Come
dawn approaches, the marathon is beginning to take its toll. Corbin and Carrière are now just 30 seconds ahead of the next three teams. The Canadians forge on, and after 8 hours at the Five Channels Dam, they hold a healthy 6-minute lead. Fatigue plays an ever greater role as the paddlers struggle with the portages. Corbin and Carrière grind remorselessly onwards. With victory secured, the course record becomes their target. After a record 13 hours and 58 minutes and an estimated 55,000 paddle strokes, they become the first team to complete the course in under 14 hours. Second place goes to Toronjo and Kolka, 10 minutes behind. It's the Canadian second successive win, and Corbin ties the record of 9 victories in the AuSable, North America's most grueling canoe marathon. Hosts pole position in the medals table, followed by Cyprus and Luxembourg. Not everyone here will gain the success that Jan dreams of, but for the great and the small, these games have provided a lesson in the value of winning, losing, and just taking part. In 1541, the explorer Jacques Cartier made his way up the St. Lawrence River in search of the mythical kingdom of Saguenay, where legend spoke of countless duels. At Stadacona, he founded the settlement which is today known as Quebec, but he found no gems, and back in his native France, as false as a Canadian diamond became a common expression. It was not the most auspicious of starts. Years on, the province of Quebec enjoys its own distinct flavor, one which many of the French Canadians, who make up 80% of the region's population, feel will only be protected by seceding from the rest of the country. But on one issue, all are agreed, and each summer for the past 63 years, thousands have gathered along the banks of the Saint Maurice to witness one of canoeing's greatest races, La Classique Internationale de Canots. As the third leg of North America's famous Triple Crown, La Classique has assumed an importance which, according to the race organizer, is felt throughout the region.
There'll be somewhere in the region of 150,000 people who come and visit, a huge number of tourists, and the financial repercussions for the province are enormous. We're talking about several million dollars. I think we've managed to create something now which the people who live here have embraced enthusiastically. And for the past 2 years, we've also worked really hard to develop the tourist side of the event.
The man all the fans have come to see compete is local favourite Serge Corbin. As an 18-time winner of the event, he's in a unique position to assess the problems a canoeist might face over the 3 days of competition.
The biggest problems are caused by the weather affecting the waves and the boat. If it's cold, the race becomes that much more difficult. But the two things you can't afford to do are drop the pace or lose your position. If you do, I guarantee you won't finish the race.
Corbin is the stern paddler of the number one boat, His partner is an American who made his name as a kayakist, winning double gold at the Seoul Olympics in 1988, as well as bronze in 1984 and 92. As a relative newcomer to this race, Greg Barton is expecting some problems, but nothing insurmountable.
You spend a full year, months and months, hours a day, training and training, and you get to the race, then if this is the big one of the year, you'll pull through it. And you'll hit some periods where you'll kind of have a lull, you'll feel really bad, you'll feel like you can't go on, but if you just settle down, maybe lower the pace a little bit, get something to eat, something to drink, try to settle in, and if you've worked that hard to come this far, you're usually willing to push it a little bit further to the finish.
This is the view that most of the other competitors will have of Barton and Corbin over the next 3 days. Day one for the 44 teams is the small matter of a 70-mile canoe from La Tuque down river to Grand Mare. Marathon canoe racing has its own particular skills and requirements. So too does racing on the Saint Maurice River. One of the byproducts of that combination is the presence of feeder boats, which meet the canoes in midstream almost every hour, replenishing supplies of food and drink. At the head of affairs, inevitably, are Barton and Corbin, although Tim Tribold and Al Rutquist in canoe number 88 and Eric Julien and Denis Bertium in number 35 are also challenging for the lead. Another strong contender is boat number zero of Patrick Lynch and Normand Mangy, a two-time winner of La Classique with Corbin. But it's Barton and Corbin who reach the finish line first, covering the course in a time of 8 hours, 57 minutes and 39 seconds. No other team breaks 9 hours. And the leaders have long since retired for the night by the time the husband and wife team of Maurice and Denise Sauvé cross the line 2 hours later. The next morning, the races are off again, but today, distance is not the determining factor. For the canoeists are about to embark on the equally daunting and exhausting matter of the portage. Barton and Corbin succeed in reaching the portage first, a huge bonus since the narrow course prevents anyone from overtaking and making up lost time. But if the portage is tough for the two-man teams, it's a nightmare for the 13-strong crews of the Rabascas. These traditional boats are engaged in their own race, although their times are not hugely different to the C2 class. As the leaders prepare to re-enter the water, Lynch and Mangy have finally managed to get past Barton and Corbin, but only just. Tribold and Rutquist are but a few paces behind them. The third and final portage of the day takes the competitors through the streets of Shawinigan. Huge crowds are on hand to encourage the races. The teams of Lynch and Mangy and Barton and Corbin are still separated by no more than a few seconds. Although the former lead at the end of the portage, the latter proved their strength in the water by coming back to win a sprint finish. The strain is beginning to show. Day three dawns as bright and beautiful as the previous two, allaying Corbin's fears of a cold front. The final day's racing sees yet more evidence of the special tactics involved. Just as in cycling, the canoeists all try and surf in the wake of the boat in front. Similarly, they'll drop the pace to encourage others to move to the front and then attack like a sprinter jumping off the front of the peloton. And when all is said and done, and the portage is lifted and run, it's Greg Barton and Serge Corbin who take the checkered flag. Corbin's 19th Classique victory also guarantees him the Triple Crown. The early French explorers may have failed to uncover any jewels in these parts, but there's nothing fake about the man from Shawinigan. Serge Corbin is the real deal.